Recently, we've discussed the cost of attending Arizona's state universities. Board of Regents President Eileen Klein discussed the results of a university cost study, and State Attorney General Mark Brnovich joined us to question that study and explain why he's filed suit over the cost of a university education. Tonight, we hear from Arizona State University President Michael Crow. Good to see you again. Thanks for joining
us. Happy to be here.
Attorney General says as free as possible, that mandate in the Constitution is simply not being met.
Well, we are meeting that mandate. So we've got more Arizona students than we've ever had. We've got them graduating in numbers that they never graduated in before. We've created a financial structure and a financial system where families can afford to come to the university and find a way to move forward with a world-class education. It's a bigger equation than just the cost of tuition. It's a whole thing about what are we delivering.
He also says that some of the numbers you just gave and some other numbers that have been talked about, it's basically cherry-picking data to try to come up with the numbers that suit the universities the best. Again, how do you respond?
Well, that's not true. That's what someone that doesn't understand the data would say. So it takes a while to become familiar with the complexity of 50,000 students and their financial aid structure from Arizona. It takes a while to understand the private philanthropies that we have, the government philanthropy, or the government support from the federal government for financial aid, the university financial aid. And so the Attorney General or anyone else that would like to see how all of that works, we're happy to lay it all out. It's pretty much customized to the individual student, and we're operating in a way where families can rest assured that they can find a way to get through the university and make it affordable.
So the idea, and the Board of Regents Chair Eileen Klein mentioned this as well, the idea of conflating cost with the actual price, is that what's going on here, do you think?
No, I think what's going on, so the cost of attendance is substantially higher than tuition. We've got really three numbers on the table. We know our market price, what is someone willing to pay to go to ASU, who's not from Arizona, is about $30,000 a year. We know our cost is substantially less than that, about $15,000 a year. We know our in-state tuition is about $10,000 a year, and we know that we can, on that $10,000 basis, we can come up with financial aid packages, no loans, grants, that on average can drive that down substantially down below $2,500, $2,200 on average. We know how that works, and so we're comfortable with the fact that our stated tuition is a third of our market price, $30,000, and our average tuition paid, that is by the student themselves, with the rest of the tuition being paid by grants, mm-hmm. is about a 15th of that market price. So we're comfortable that we've created a really good situation for Arizonans.
I must say, when the Attorney General was on the program, he wasn't comfortable with the price, the cost, the whole nine yards. And again, when I asked him about that, here's what he had to say.
Is they can say all they want that all the actual costs or what people are paying, they can say it all on. The reality is that most middle-class parents here in Arizona are paying more than they say. Or alternatively, Ted, just because you can get jacked up with a bunch of loans, that's part of their how much loans someone can or can't get, that's not what the framers of the Constitution wanted.
Again, back to the as nearly free as possible.
Right, so about 40% of our students graduate with no debt at all. We're pretty happy about that. We keep the average debt 25% below the national average, well below the national average in many realms. But to the point that the Attorney General was mentioning about price versus cost, it turns out that the cost is $15,000. The tuition is $10,000. The package that we put together for some families to help pay for the $10,000, we still have to pay that. We still have to pay that cost. We still need the resources. We go out and raise private philanthropy. We make this work in different ways. We use university resources. The federal government has Pell Grants. All of these things together create a dynamic way for us to make this happen. This notion that somehow these are not accurate numbers, well, that's just absurd.
And you're saying 2,200, something along those lines is the average?
Well, that's on average. So if you look, for instance, in the middle class, we just looked at these numbers. I just looked at these numbers yesterday. The families receiving the most financial aid from the university itself are families in the middle class and up because they don't have access to federal Pell Grants. They don't have access to some other things. And so it turns out that the way that we've structured the financial aid system, the financial aid means us finding resources to pay the tuition for someone that we want to support paying tuition for. The middle class is not disadvantaged by the university in any way.
And to that point, the Attorney General asked that the next time you're on the program, this question be asked.
My question this is next time, you know, the Regents or Michael Crow comes on, if the actual cost is really only what people are paying is only $2,000 or $3,000, then why isn't that the price of tuition?
So that's the actual cost is $15,000, actually slightly higher than that. The cost of attendance is well above the tuition. We have to generate resources from all aspects of the university. We have to generate resources from our out-of-state students, from our real estate assets, from our other things that we're doing. We have to generate enough resources to cover the cost, $15,000 plus per student. The tuition is below that, so we have a net loss on every student, and then we help students to pay the tuition level for in-state students.
Is this a deal where the Attorney General is looking at a car and seeing the sticker price, and you are the dealer saying that's not the actual cost, there are other things going on here?
No, it's not that at all. What this is the cost of attendance is above $15,000 a year. Our tuition doesn't even cover that. We have to generate other resources, some investment from the state, some investment from other sources, and we have to build a financial aid model on top of that. The cost is the cost. It costs us that much money to educate a student. And we have to then derive resources from every possible angle to be able to make that affordable to an Arizonan, but also to have the dollars to provide the education.
Attorney General also mentioned that he said that this study, this university cost study, blew off, his words, blew off two fundamental questions in his lawsuit. First question was research versus actual classroom instruction. Was that overlooked in this university cost study?
No, research is financed by research grants, research activities, and some of the activities of the faculty. That's not a factor here. In fact, among research universities, we have among the lowest costs. In fact, we're probably within the bottom 5 or 10% of universities in terms of costs that are research universities. We have a number of factors that we have used technologies to lower our costs. We've used a range of things to lower our costs. We're well below our competitors in terms of cost, and research is not a driver of our costs.
And to that point, again, one last note here from the Attorney General when he appeared on the program. We mentioned that, research versus non-research costs. He talked about some of the numbers you talked about, and here's what he had to say.
This is part of the university shell game, is that when it comes to research costs versus non-research costs, we were not getting provided that data. For example, the ASU Foundation doesn't believe it's subject to public records requests. So a lot of these questions, these issues, we don't know the answers to.
He says that the information is either not there or it can't be found. And so is that part of the confusion here? What's going on?
You know, it's a complicated institution. So the ASU Foundation, for instance, supplies about $100 million of philanthropy to the university per year to help operate the university. That's on a $3 billion budget. And so these are big, complex institutions driven by one objective, graduating as many Arizonans from every family imaginable with world-class quality degrees. We're now doing that. The institution has not historically done that as well as it's being done right now. We didn't have the resources. We didn't have the financial aid packages. We didn't have the means to make things work. We now have all of that together. There's no obfuscation here. The Attorney General uses, you know, lingo. A shell game, other kinds of things. We don't operate that way. We have governing boards, we have auditors, we have review mechanisms. All these things are in place constantly. We probably have hundreds of funding sources coming in from everywhere, all of whom are auditing what we're doing, and so there are no shell games.
The last question he said that was not addressed in this university cost study was comparing online learning versus classroom learning, And he wants to know why it costs more to attend ASU online than it does in person.
It doesn't. Our online programs are offered on an a la carte basis. What we mean is that you purchase one course at a time versus a complete tuition for the entire semester. As the end of this semester, we'll make certain that no one who a la carte is buying more courses than it would cost to attend in person will pay anything above that in-person state tuition. And so we don't have very many students that do that, and we'll just make sure that the a la carte cost is never higher than the all-in cost of attending on campus.
So in regard to the lawsuit, Attorney General is obviously passionate about this. He filed a lawsuit, and he's backing it up, and he comes on the program, and he's very into this. Where's the disconnect? What's going on here?
I'm not sure. So he never spoke to us about it before he filed the lawsuit. He's our lawyer. And so he's acting in an unusual way. I mean, our own lawyer suing us without a conversation is an unusual method of gaining information or gaining insight. You know, I appreciate his concern. I understand that he's concerned about how we can shape and move things forward to be of greater service. And so we're always willing to sit down and talk and work it through and work things through, change things, improve things, enhance things. Any state leader, such as the Attorney General, would be someone that we'd sit with immediately. It's just, you know, this is the out of the box, the first conversation. It's like going to your neighbor and saying, I don't like your hedges. I had them pulled out. And I'm suing you also. And so it's just not the way to start the conversation.
What about the conversation? We've got a couple of minutes left here. A conversation regarding a House Bill 2280, no leaseback deals on Board of Regents land. Basically, you can't lease back to private lessors for commercial use. You are against this idea. Talk to us about it.
So the deal there is people are saying to the universities, listen, we don't have much money from the state to fund you for the university itself. Our funding is down 60% per student per year. Okay, fine. We then come up with other revenue sources to advance the university, including using property that's been given to us, property that's not being used by the university yet. So we're not real estate developers, but we are university developers. In Texas, they use state land to generate oil revenues off of state lands for the universities. We don't have any oil revenues. We're not using state lands. We're using public lands that are a part of the university. Can we generate some revenue from those for a while? And the people that are proposing this are opposed to us having that kind of revenue. They believe that it's disruptive to the overall tax structure, that we're taking revenue away from other public responsibilities and public duties. We have a public responsibility and a public duty, and that is to fund the university. We have no property tax base. We have no sales tax base. We have no guaranteed revenue source. We have no funding model from the state. And so we are using all of our assets to generate revenue to make the university work.
So when a proponent of this says that local governments, because of this, local governments are not getting revenue that they would otherwise have, you say?
No, because the land is not on the tax rolls to begin with. One of the projects that people have been concerned about was on land given to the university 60 years ago. That land sat fallow. It was a junkyard. Now we found a temporary use for it that can generate some revenue. When that temporary use is done, whatever was built on that site, we own, and we still own the land. And so the university has to take a look at things over decades or even centuries. You know, we're looking at what will the university need 150 years from now. So if we can generate some revenue from a piece of property between now and 50 years from now, we should do that.
Limiting the usage to academic pursuits, student housing, these sorts of things, as opposed to commercial enterprises.
No, if we can generate income from folks that are commercial enterprises that want to be near the university, we think that that can work on a temporary basis. And this is a common undertaking for private universities around the country.
Last question. Is this just something that is difficult for lawmakers to understand? Is it too complicated? Could it be simplified?
You know, I think that there is an issue about how complicated all of this is, you know, the notion of who's paying for college and how does it work and so forth. What I do know is that I do look at our bottom line. Our bottom line is that if you came to ASU 4 years ago and you had an A average, you had a 71% chance of graduating within 4 years. We've never had anything like that before. If you came with a B average, the average graduation rate in 4 years for a kid in the country with a B average is around 15%. Ours is 46%. So what we do know is that it's complicated. If you sit down with us as a family, if you sit down with us as a student and your family, we will make it possible for you to attend and graduate from ASU.
And the Attorney General will say, and he said that on the program, he went to ASU in the 1980s, graduated without debt, paid $600 or some odd a semester, and he doesn't understand why that can't be similar.
So around the year he graduated, our four-year graduation rate was 13%. Almost no one graduated. There was no diversity in the student body. And it turns out that if you take our, and I've run these calculations since he has questioned them again, just to make sure that I was right and these numbers are accurate, that in 2017-2018 dollars, our present net tuition is about the same, actually a little bit less than the equivalent of the tuition back 30 years ago. The difference is the institution had no resources. The institution was not graduating students. The institution was not serving its community. Now, the Attorney General has said, and I agree with him, we need more options. We need more ways to advance the university and higher education options. So we've started bachelor's degree programs in Lake Havasu. We've started bachelor's degree programs in Eastern Arizona College in Thatcher. We've started our online programs. We're driving those forward. We're working on other ideas and other projects. We have lower tuition programs in certain areas of the institution. We think we can do more of those and drive those forward. And so, yes, we're doing everything we can to find pathways for people to gain access to what it is that we have, which is the ability to produce a person educated at a level where they can compete in the economy that's emerging. If we weren't graduating anyone, we're a failure. If we have no resources to graduate anyone, we're a failure. We're now no longer operating in a modality where we're not succeeding. We are succeeding.
ASU President Michael Crow, thank you so much for joining us. We appreciate it.
All right, thank you.
Thank you. Coming up, it's our favorite physicist, Lawrence Krauss, with the latest on science news.